the affairs from the heavens to the earth. And all these go up to him on a day which is equal to 1,000 years of reckoning. If you translate the word correctly, yom, as period, it will read that Allah rules all the affairs from the heavens to the earth, and all of them go unto him in a period which is equal to 1,000 years of your reckoning. Surah Ma'arij chapter 70 verse number 4 reads that the spirits and the angels, they ascend unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a day which is equal to 50,000 years of your reckoning. If you translate it correctly, yom as period, it will read that the spirits and the angels ascend unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a period equal to 50,000 years. The Quran is referring to two different periods. Therefore, there's no contradiction. For example, if I say, I will take 1 hour to reach Washi, I will take a period of 1 hour to reach Washi, and then say, I will take a period of 50 hours to reach Srinagar, to reach Kashmir. It's not contradicting, because both are different periods. So one place Quran says, the period required for all the spirits and the angels to go up unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is equal to 50,000 years of your reckoning. And the other place says, the period required for all the affairs to go unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is 1,000 years. There's no contradiction in that. I hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum, Zakir bhai. My name is Shakir and I'm a mechanical engineer student. I would like to ask you a question that how can you prove to an atheist scientifically the existence of God?
The brother has posed the question, how can you scientifically prove the existence of God Almighty, the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially to an atheist who does not believe in God? The first thing I will do is that I will congratulate that atheist. I'll congratulate him. You know why? If you look around us, he's a Hindu because father is a Hindu. He's a Christian because father is a Christian. Some Muslims are Muslim because their fathers are Muslim. This person, though he may be coming from a religious background, he does not believe in the false God which his parents attribute to. So he does not believe in God. I'm congratulating him because he's accepted the first part of the Shahada, the first part of the Islamic creed, La ilaha, there is no God. Now my job is to prove illallah, but Allah, which I shall do inshallah. To the other people, I have to first remove the wrong concept of God and then prove the right concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here half my job is done. He has already said La ilaha, there's no God. Now I have to prove illallah, but Allah, which I shall do inshallah. You ask this atheist that suppose there is an object, an unidentified, maybe a flying object, which no one in the world has seen. No human being in the world knows about this object. If it's brought in front of you, and if you're asked that who will be the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of this unidentified object, you have to ask him the question. Who is the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of this new object which no one in the world has seen? After thinking for a while, he'll give the answer. The person who will be able to tell you the mechanism, the first person, is the creator of that object. Some may say manufacturer, some may say producer. Whatever they say, don't grapple with the word, accept it. It will be somewhat similar, either creator or producer or manufacturer. But remember what he has told you. Keep it in your mind. Then ask him the next question. How did the universe come into existence? How was it formed? He will tell you by the Big Bang Theory. Tell him the Quran mentions in Surah Anbiya, chapter 21, verse number 30, about the Big Bang Theory. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran 1400 years ago? So he will tell you, maybe it's a fluke. Don't argue with him. Next part of the question. We did not know that the light of the moon is reflected light. We came to know recently. You ask him, he'll tell you, yes, yes. The light of the moon is reflected light. It's not its own light. When we discovered, he will tell you recently, yesterday, 50 years back, 100 years back, yesterday in science. You tell him, the Quran mentioned that the light of the moon is reflected light 1400 years ago. Who could have mentioned that? Maybe somebody had a wild guess. Don't argue with him. Continue. We thought the sun was stationary. You ask him, is it stationary? He'll say, no. It's rotating and revolving. When you learn this, he will tell you yesterday, 50 years back, 20 years back. Quran mentioned this 1400 years ago. He will hesitate, but may say, maybe some intelligent person wrote it. Don't argue with him. Continue. How was the universe initially? What is celestial matter? He will tell you, it was smoke. How did you come to know? We have got proof, we have got evidence. You tell him, Quran mentioned this 1400 years ago. Who could have mentioned that? He will hesitate. Don't wait for response. Continue. Keep on posing question after question. All that I give in the lecture, keep on posing one question after the other. That, what a cycle. How do we come to know about it? Quran mentioned 1400 years ago. About every living thing made from water. Who could have mentioned that? Quran speaks about botany, the male and female. Who could have mentioned that? Pose one after the other and ask the question, who could have written that? Then you tell him that there's a theory known as theory of probability. That if you have two choices, out of which one is right, the chances that you will make the correct choice, just at random, is 1 in 2. For example, if I toss a coin, it can either be heads or tails. The chances that I'll be right will be 1 in 2. If I toss it twice, the chances that I'll be right both the times will be 1/2 multiplied by 1/2, that is 1/4, 25% chance. If I toss it thrice, chances I'll be right all three times, 1/2 multiplied by 1/2 multiplied by 1/2, it's 1/8, 12.5%. A dice has got 6 sides. If I throw a dice, the chances that at random I'll be correct is 1/6. If I throw it twice, the chances that both the time I'll be right will be 1/6 by 1/6, 1/36. This is called as theory of probability. If I throw the dice twice and then toss a coin, all three being right will be 1/6 by 1/6 by 1/2, is 1/72. So you ask him, the chances may be, if you ask, what is the shape of the earth? There are various shapes. Some may say it is flat, some may say it's triangular, some may say it is hexagonal, some may say pentagonal, some may say heptagonal, some may say square. Say there can be 10 shapes. Some may say it is round, it is spherical. The chances that if anyone makes a wild guess, it being correct, is 1/10. The light of the moon, it can either be its own light or it can be reflected light. The chances that you make a wild guess and it being correct will be 1/2. The chances that both shape of the earth and light of the moon being reflected light, both being correct, if you make a wild guess, it will be 1/10 multiplied by 1/2, it is 1/20. What can the living creatures be made of? Some may say sand, some may say stone, some may say aluminium, some may say gold, say 1,000 materials you can name. Some may say water, some may say silver, 1,000 materials. The chances that you make a wild guess, and one of them being right, according to mathematics, is 1/1,000. The chances that all three being correct, the earth is spherical, light of the moon is reflected light, and every living creature created from water is correct, will be 1/10 multiplied by 1/2 multiplied by 1/1,000. Answer comes to 1/20,000, or 0.005%. Quran speaks about scientific science more than 1,000 verses. In 3 verses, the chance comes to 0.05%. If you apply probability theory to all this being a random chance, it will come to 0, negligible. And in maths, anything 1 in 10 raised to 50.